Hi there!
Hello! We are GastroGays. My name is Russell.
And I'm Patrick.
And this is our top 10 for Eurovision 2017.
We don't do top 43 or top 20
or top anything else.
Only a top 10. These are our 10 favourite tracks of Eurovision 2017.
Now, they are just our favourite tracks. This does not mean that this is what we are saying is going to be the top 10. It's just the 10 tracks that we are obsessed with at the moment.
But in an ideal world, these would be our perspective top 10.
Some might say that it's actually a good thing that we're not in charge of it all. Let's begin with the first of our countries, which we're randomly selecting from our top 10. We're going to talk about Italy. So Italy.
Francesco Gabbani.
Great song. Absolutely brilliant song. We both agreed that this has to be in the, well, it is already in the final. This has to be in the top three, top five, potential winner big time. It is a bookie's favourite, it's a fan favourite.
It came out early and pretty early on we knew this would do well and that we liked it, so it was an essential in our top 10.
If you did see our reaction video to it though, there was a lot of controversy because apparently we were ignorant that we didn't understand the meaning of the song. Thank you. The thing is, and it's a worry of ours throughout this contest, is when a song isn't in a widely spoken language, aka this is in Italian, by the way, which isn't one of the major spoken languages of Europe in the same way that, say, let's, for example, French is spoken in various other territories around Europe, we worry that it might be lost in translation. And when it's a great song, like Italy's one is, it might do it a bit of a disservice. We were called ignorant a lot for not understanding the meaning of it, but hey, whatever. It's a good song, it sounds good to listen to.
But maybe we are the example of everyone who's tuning in for the first time in May to see Italy perform at the final, because that is their first listen for a lot of people and their first reaction. And ours was kind of confusion about the theme or the topic and the ape that's dancing.
Yes, so a dancing ape, whatever that is about.
It's connected to the song.
Exactly.
But is everyone going to understand that?
In 3 minutes, it is up to the national commentators to make sure that everyone is aware of that. But will they? There's no guarantee.
But there's no doubt that this is a fun song. It's a party song. He performs it really, really well. He has high energy and this is going to do well in anyone's estimation.
Exactly. We are a bit sad that they've cut out the second verse of the song in order to trim it down to the desired 3 minute bracket. But it's still a very good song. A good chance for the crown. We could be seeing Rome 2018.
So from one eye to another, we go from Italy to our next pick, which is Iceland, and the artist is Svala. The
song is called Paper, and it is a really, really amazing track. Now we've been burned by Iceland a couple of times before, where we have said that this song is definitely going to the final. Last year we said Greta was gonna win the contest.
We think this will get into the final, and is a really, really strong entry from Iceland. We've willed them to get to the top spot for many, many years, and we think this is one of their strongest entries yet. Svala is a really established artist in Iceland, so obviously the Icelandic people are going to be behind her, and we think Europe will be as well.
Wasn't she a judge on The Voice in Iceland as well? So, you know, very, very popular amongst residents there. It's a very, very commercial friendly song. Yeah. It just depends on how it's going to be performed on the night.
I think there's going to be a light show. I'm expecting drums maybe. I'm expecting her to be a captivating performer. I think one of our big criticisms in our reaction video was that the drop towards the end of the song isn't kind of punchy enough. But depending on performance wise, this could work really, really well.
Very excited to see that in May. Third of our 10 choices for this year is Blanche for Belgium. The song is called City Lights, and this is such an amazing song just to listen to alone. Yeah. I think we've played it on repeat for weeks ever since we heard it for the very first time.
It's contemporary, it's modern, it's cool, it's just bringing Eurovision into the present day, and I think it would be a fitting winner, and we would love to see Belgium host.
over the last couple of weeks, there's been a lot of the preview shows for a lot of the fans in different countries, such as here in London, there's been one in Israel, and there's one in Amsterdam as well. And a lot of the feedback that's come out from it is that, oh, it's a little bit boring, like she can sing, but it's very, very boring. Now, I'm just going to make a very, very should-be-obvious point that a stage in a small venue like in London where the Eurovision party was held is very, very different to the stage where Eurovision itself is going to be hosted in Kiev. There's no lights, no pyrotechnics, no wind machines. It really is just the performer on stage singing.
Yeah.
You know, let's look at Russia's performance last year in 2016. I hardly think he was climbing all over the stage when that was being performed. Fact is, it is all dependent on what's happening on the night. So I'm not going to judge it on
you
any of those comments.
Them.
On the night is the most important thing. She stands completely still, they've lost it. They lost probably their best hope for years. It all depends on what is going on around as well.
So already you can see a theme. The performance really matters. And that's an element that we won't get to see until the week of Eurovision. So, I mean, you can have your favourites, but if the performance is good, it can soar. If the performance is not ideal, it can crash out. So, on to our next pick.
How about we talk about one that we really think is all about the performance?
Okay. Artsvik for Armenia, and her song is called Fly With Me. Now, this was the last song declared this year.
So I suppose we've had the least amount of time to listen to it.
And in that short space of time, we've probably played it one of the most.
Yes. This is a real performance song. What we mean by that is that it is entirely dependent on how it looks on camera on the night. People listening to it on the radio in particular or playing it on Spotify may not enjoy this song half as much as we do watching it.
Yeah.
But if the official video is anything to go by, the performance is going to be pretty special and pretty cool to watch.
Yeah. It has that kind of universal appeal that could really join up East and West Europe, and I think it's got a really commercial angle as well. I am really, really excited about this performance.
Now, we're not saying that this is going to win, but this is going to be something that I think will shock a lot of people.
Yeah.
It's going to come quite high and hopefully qualify for the final. We reckon it will. And it is entirely all about the performance. It has to look great. And if, you know, watch the video if you haven't seen it already. If you have listened to the song and you don't like it, take a look at the video and you'll see what we mean. They basically have it ready made there.
Yeah. Armenia have been high in the bookies' odds quite a few times in the past few years.
Mm.
So if previous history is anything to go by, they could be a contender this year.
Exactly.
Next up, we have Finland, Norma John with Blackbird. This song captivated me the first time I heard it.
This is his, like, absolute favourite song.
Yeah. Pretty much when we were doing our top 10s individually to then combine them into this one.
Yours was just Finland.
This was the first one I put down because I just love this song. And I think it would be a deserving winner. It's something a little different for Eurovision. It's not your typical. And what I would like to see is that Finland get another chance at winning and hosting, because their last one, Lordi, everyone associates with Finland, and it's a little bit of a joke now, so...
Like, Lordi were deserving winners
yeah.
in the context of the contest, but we always kind of say that that 2000 to 2009 years were very much the wilderness years of
it
the
was
modern
the cold era.
The modern day contest. It wasn't very good. There's a lot of change in the voting and semi-finals and everything like that. It was very, very confused. And an act like Lordi won, not only for being memorable, but it just had the appeal of being a bit of a joke act.
Yeah.
Even though, you know, they are Eurovision legends and I don't want to upset them for fear of them hurting me.
I think the piano element in this is especially special. That kind of instrumental portion towards the end is really, really important, and I don't think we've seen something like that in Eurovision in quite a while, as captivating as this is.
True. It has taken a while for us to kind of have a real, like, musical moment. We're obsessed with this 3 minutes to be filled, and hence we've made comments in the past about abrupt endings, which is rife in this particular contest.
Yeah.
That's very, very frustrating. This one uses those 3 minutes so, so effectively and beautifully. So, you know, I'm excited to see how it performs and how it fares in the contest. It would be a very deserving winner if it does get to that point. Next act in our top 10 is Bulgaria. This is Christian Kostov. His song is called Beautiful Mess, and it is a beautiful song.
There's nothing messy about this song at all.
He's the youngest competitor in the contest this year, the Sandra Kim of Kiev, but it's nothing like Sandra Kim. It's fantastic. It's actually kind of one of these voices that when you pair it up with his look, you kind of go, oh my god, how can this child out with this amazing vocal? He is so, so talented. And obviously the age thing will really sell it for him. But it's a great song. If, you know, this week Harry Styles released his new record, and in a way, if you said, oh, this was Harry Styles,
you would believe it.
You kind of would believe it. Now I'm sure people would go, oh my god, you don't know anything. But that's the kind of way I feel. It has that real commercial appeal. It's a very, very strong song.
Well, I think this year there's a lot of people who are around the 17, 18 age mark, so obviously they're going to be compared. And this is also the year of the boy ballad. So we have a lot of young guys with incredible voices who are all going to be pitched against each other. And we think this stands just that little bit above quite a few of the other ones. I think in terms of performance, which is interesting for Eurovision, they just have to let him sing on stage and he will captivate everyone. And it's rare that you would kind of expect a performance to be very low-key and just a performer, but I think that would be perfect here.
Yeah, I really am excited to see this. I think it's a bit of an underdog because it was one of the later songs to be released in the whole contest. Bulgaria has only in the last two or three years really been, well, last year, let's face it, really pushing the boat out with their entries. So this has a good chance, and I'm excited, so excited to see how this turns out, because I think it's going to be a good, good effort from Bulgaria. Speaking of boy bands, though,
just like
boy ballads, not bands.
Just like in May, should we compare it with the one it's going to be compared the most with?
Not Ireland. Ireland just fell outside of our top 10.
Yeah, there was a whisper of it somewhere, but didn't make it.
The competitor that we feel Bulgaria has is Australia.
Isaiah Fye Rice for Australia, and the song is Don't Come Easy.
We weren't in love with this at first. It did take a few listens, and now we really, really, really like this song.
It's a real grower.
Yeah, it is a real grower. Now, does that come across as a bad thing? Because, of course, people will only have one listen to it on Eurovision night if it gets into the final. But I love it. I think it is a really, really strong entry. Not the strongest from Australia, but I think it's a good competitor in this kind of field where you have a lot of strong male vocalists.
Yeah. Australia are performing in semi-final one, whereas Bulgaria are performing in semi-final two. So if the two of them get into the final, they will be directly compared. And imagine if they are performing quite close together in the running order. They will be directly compared. And that would be exciting, though.
Yeah, it would be. We like a little bit of a dual battle going on at Eurovision in some way. Let's see if the producers think the same.
But tell us, listen to these songs side by side and tell us your opinion in the comments. Who is your favourite? Who do you think might have the edge over the other one?
Oh, just of those two?
Yeah.
Yeah, because obviously that's what we're asking. Next one. We're going into a territory now where we don't necessarily agree on the songs, so we sometimes fight. Let's go on to one of them, shall we? Let's talk about Estonia. Guess which one of us loves Estonia?
I can't.
Me. Ah, oh, Estonia, Estonia. Despite the fact I absolutely love this song, I still can't pronounce the artist's name. I think it's Koit Tumi. And Laura can do that one. Now, you absolutely hate this, and I'm pretty sure half of my love for this song is just to antagonise you further. But I love this song. It's so crappily cheesy that it just makes me smile. It's a really, really pop-friendly, you know, easy to listen to song. It's so catchy, and I can tell you there's someone else in this room right now who sings along with it as much as I do.
He's not talking about me. Okay, I like the chorus.
I think that's it.
I think it is very catchy and it will stick in people's memories, but I was introduced to this song in the live performance of the national selection and
it was awful.
Absolutely diabolical, vocal-wise. And from then on, I just thought, this is not current, it's not modern, it's not groundbreaking,
it is lost
cheesy.
In Verona.
It's lost. And I hope it gets lost in my mind.
I hope it wins. No, I don't think it's going to win, but I think it will touch the hearts of many people, and at least I hope so, because I think it is a decent track.
Okay, enough about Estonia. We're nearing the end. Next one we have Azerbaijan.
Thankfully, we are back in agreement land.
So, Dihaj with the song Skeletons was an instant entry into our top 10.
Oh my god, we adore this from the second we heard it. It is such a amazing song of 2017, not just in Eurovision, but in general. Yeah. It's a strong, strong entry from an already consistently strong nation.
Yeah. It's quite a departure for Azerbaijan, we think, and it's a nice kind of twist on their usual impeccable performance at Eurovision. They always like to give us something different and change it up every year, and this is no exception. We think it's going to do really well, and I think it could come in the top 5.
I think so too. It is a real, real crowd pleaser. Mm-hmm. My only criticism, as I said again, but I think as I listen to it more, I'm less critical, is the layering up of voices constantly in the chorus. It is a little bit jarring, and I'm the type of person who can't have too many voices going on at one time because I get a bit confused. Poor me.
There's one high note in the chorus.
Yes, that has to be held.
It has to be hit as well. If that's not hit properly, this song will not do well.
Which, you know, as you have always said, if you don't hit the notes, you don't get the votes.
Copyright. On to our last, to round out our top 10, it's the place that we live.
Peckham.
United Kingdom.
Oh, United Kingdom.
Lucy Jones with Never Give Up On You.
We were at the selection show where Lucy was chosen.
Yes.
We have documented that it wasn't our first choice because we had a love affair of another song, but this was a very, very, very good close second. We are really in love with this song. We won't give up on it.
It has been tweaked.
Yes.
Which we don't agree on. One of us thinks it has improved it. One of us thinks it has made it a little less
improved. The problem that you have really is the fact that they've unnecessarily added in extra beats and everything, whereas I think that has helped it.
And a zhroom. A boom. A zhroom.
I kind of wish they went along the steps line and went whoom. It is still an epic song, and I still think it's going to be performed very, very simply, very, very stripped back. It just gives it a bit more of a pace.
I loved the brevity and the kind of gravitas of just her on the stage, her voice absolutely, you know, hitting every note crystal clear. Maybe smoke, maybe dark lighting. I just thought that would be really dramatic and captivating. I think the tweaked version has played that down a bit and it's added in unnecessary elements, but
this is Eurovision! You have to grab people's attention, and the UK, whether you agree or not, is going to find it a little bit more difficult. There is a lot of anti-UK sentiment going on in Europe because of Brexit, and we are the first people to shout that Eurovision is not political and this political bloc voting stuff is all something that's left in the past. But something like Brexit, in a thing that unifies Europe, that is Eurovision, we do fear will play a little part in some people's minds, not everyone's. So that does have to be played into account. I do think it's going to do well though.
So do
despite
I.
Despite that little worry. It is one of the best entries the UK has sent in a long time. And I think, yeah, this is going to be a strong entry. I definitely see it on the left-hand side of the board. And it seems the Eurovision fan community are in love with that.
The thing that will determine that will be the order of placement on the night.
Not song two.
If it's first or even in the first 5, I think it will get lost. But if it's positioned quite well on the night, I think it could earn a lot of votes.
So, That is it. That is our top 10. If you want to read a little bit more, there is a post on gastrogays.com about all of our top 10 if you are a fan of the written word.
There's also the countries in that just missed out on a placement in our top 10, the ones that we really do like and that we came to blows over, I have to say.
Like, it was all like voting and agreeing and arguing and everything. It's not just that we picked a top 10 out of our... Yes.
So if you're interested to know which ones were just pipped to the post, go check out that.
Thank you for watching. Don't forget you can follow us on all these social channels at GastroGays as well as our website. But thank you for watching.
See you next time.
Bye.